Thank you, Char and Fred, for agreeing to do this video interview with us today. For our viewing audience, can you both introduce yourselves to our video audience?
Sure. My name is Charlene Wells, and I am from Albuquerque, New Mexico.
My name is Fred Wells, and I'm from Albuquerque, New Mexico.
Can you please share with our audience here your first exposure to what has now become human performance technology? When did you first come across this?
Well, my first exposure was actually attending a series of ISPI conferences. The first conference I went to certainly focused on HPT, but what I gleaned from it was more around training and the performance-based approach to training. So that was a bit of my entree point, if you will. And then as I become more familiar with the whole training methodology, which I knew a lot about at the time, I learned to understand a bit more about what HPT was all about and became a certified trainer for Harless Performance Guild.
Mm-hmm. And Fred, what was your first exposure to all of this?
My first exposure to what is now called HPT came through the traditional training game. I was a traditional trainer in several different assignments, and I got moved to the corporate headquarters of a very large corporation in New York City. And I discovered that everything I knew about traditional training was somewhat off course.
Mm-hmm.
And I was assigned to my staff was a gentleman by the name of Dr. Harry Shoemaker, who had a graduate degree and a doctorate from Colorado University, as I recall, in things that we now know are related to human performance.
Mm-hmm.
And Harry took me in tow and taught me about what we call then instructional technology.
Mm-hmm.
And instructional technology was the door to HPT.
Aha. So besides Harry and the ISPI itself, Char, who have been your biggest influences? People, books, articles? What do you feel you would attribute your great insights and to your practice here? What would you do? Who would you attribute that to, or what sources?
Two primarily. I'll take that back. Probably three. When I was completing my degree work at the university, I was in vocational education. And so vocational education, being what it is all performance-based. That's what it's all about. So I kind of felt like I had a really good understanding of it. And when I started working in the Bell system, one of the things I wanted to do was to be an instructor or a trainer, because I knew that that would be a way to utilize my background in learning. And by the way, all of the objective setting and all of those kinds of things that we had to do when we did what were then called learning packets would fit right in. So along with a friend of mine, we kind of posted bid and negotiated our way to the corporate learning facility, and that's where I became engaged with Harless's material.
Mm-hmm.
And fortunately for me, I passed muster as far as being certified to be Harless certified trainer for the Bell system. What that did was enhanced for me the old saying of by your pupils you'll be taught, you know, to teach is to learn twice. Well, I learned a lot just by having to learn to teach those materials.
Mm-hmm.
And exposure to instructors across the country, because there were not a lot of us that were approved at that time and certified at that time to teach those programs. And I will tell just a quick story initially. My first meeting with Joe, or one of my early meetings with Joe Harless, as well as a lady named Joyce Burbach. Joyce was our coordinator, and she knew everything there was to know, I swear, or at least I thought so at the time, about learning, and certainly knew about working with Joe Harless. But we would have these group meetings for the instructors, and I remember thinking, I was feeling pretty good because I had, you know, I joined the group and I was certified, and, you know, that meant I knew some stuff, and that felt pretty good. And then we were sitting there, and all of a sudden Joe asked the question of, how many are you having problems with the fact that the instructor guide is written inductively and the student materials are written deductively? And he lost me for the rest of the meeting. I was busy trying to figure out how that was working. And to think about somebody consciously structured it that way, you know, up until then it sort of just happened. But to suddenly realize that, you know, somebody had consciously done it that way was a new challenge for me, and I found that to be fun.
Mm-hmm.
So that was a bit of my guidance there. It caused me to say, well, now wait a minute, how would you do that, and how would you do that consciously, and how would that have to be structured to make that work?
Mm-hmm. Fred, who have you been greatly influenced by?
Well, a number of people. When I arrived at the corporate headquarters of AT&T in New York City, I had a small staff and had a few people associated with that staff that were somewhat ahead of me as far as knowing really about how people learn and about the technologies that might be employed. As a matter of fact, I was pretty much an outsider. But these people, beginning with Harry Shoemaker, sort of took me in hand. And one of the first things that Harry did is he insisted that I attend a meeting in Rochester, New York. It was a meeting of an organization called NSPI, the National Society for Performance and Instruction. It wasn't performance improvement, it was performance and instruction.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where I was mainly concentrated. At that meeting, I met someone who had been a peer of mine, but I only knew him from a distance. His name was Glenn Ballantyne.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a 3-day conference in a snowstorm at Rochester, and we didn't have a very large group, around 175, I think I was told. So that started me with NSPI, who subsequently became ISPI. Harry also introduced me to Dr. Oliver Holt, and unknown to me at that time was that the Bell System through AT&T actually had an experiment going in a learning laboratory at Piscataway, New Jersey. And so I visited that learning center and discovered that there was an environment that supported learning better than most, and how important it was. And I also began my education in instructional technology,
mm-hmm.
which I was to learn later was an entry point to HPT.
Mm-hmm.
Those two gentlemen did a quick job on me to bring me up to date, and I got interested in NSPI and became influenced. Then shortly after that, I met Joe Harless and Gary Rumler and Tom Gilbert.
Mm-hmm.
And at that time, we were conducting some experiments at AT&T on how to teach mostly men at the time how to install telephones and how to climb poles. Mm-hmm. And that was part of my responsibility. So we began a program, and it began really in the basement of my home in New Jersey with Harry and I in this large basement room developing a set of standards for the development of instruction. Mm-hmm. And we jointly developed them, but Harry was the one that had all the ideas, and I was sort of the learner in the process. But I had the organization side, and I could put those things to work. Mm-hmm. So those two gentlemen, plus Rumler, Harless, and Gilbert, had a big influence on me at that time. Later, I actually worked with all three of them at different times, and sort of extended my education in instructional technology. And then through an NSPI activity, I discovered that instructional technology was about 1/10,000th of HPT.
Mm-hmm.
And I discovered that because we had a project run by a gentleman with Arthur Anderson at the time. His name was Maury Coleman.
Mm-hmm.
And Maury is still with the society and still doing good work.
Mm-hmm.
Currently with the certification exercise or project that mm-hmm. ISPI has going at this time. But I could go on and on, Guy, about the people who have influenced me and taught me. So I had multiple mentors over the years. And finally, through a misguided election, NSPI made me president.
What year was that?
1979. 1980. And I met more experts in the various parts of the HPT field. Mm-hmm. So it's been a learning exercise for me now for 42 years.
Mm-hmm. Well, but you should talk about it. In that position as president, you were able to leverage the resources of your organization.
Yes.
To put a number of firsts in place.
Well, we did some great things. We had a very large instructional development organization, about 150 people in mm-hmm. total, working on more than 100 different training courses, and we built a model training center that exemplified the efforts I first saw at Piscataway under Dr. Oliver Holt.
Mm-hmm.
And I learned a lot about what facilitates learning with people and the things that have to occur to make it work. And but mostly I learned that all of the training that I've been associated with in the past was based on the wrong things.
Hard to learn. Let me shift.
But he left out an important part.
What's that?
The design of the logo.
Oh, well.
Yes, you were credited with establishing the NSPI logo. For those that go back in the history of the society, it's that red and white logo, correct?
Right.
Yes.
Yes. And we also established the chapter leader's handbook.
Yes.
And the workshop, the handbook, the logo.
We held the first workshop for chapter leaders, and it was not very successful, but we did have a lot of interested people there, and they took home a huge handbook, which I don't believe very many of them used at that time. But it progressed through the years, and the last chapter leaders workshop they had that I attended was 3 years ago. And it was pretty dynamic.
Mm-hmm. I attended the one this year here, and I'm here to tell you it's still dynamic. So thank you for starting that back then in 1979.
Along with those other three accomplishments, he also started the Denver chapter at the same time.
Well, we had an interesting story with the Denver chapter, which I can't resist telling. Very early in the history of the chapter, it had been in existence 5 or 6 years, the chapter decided to honor me by making me a life member of that chapter. Char and I subsequently moved to Albuquerque, and Char was instrumental in resurrecting the chapter in Albuquerque. And years went along, and the Albuquerque chapter made me an honorary life member. We occasionally attended the Denver chapter meetings, and at one of them, here 4 or 5 years ago now, they honored me with another life member award because they had lost the records of the first one. But they found them. So some interesting things have happened. If I were to pick out one thing in my learning that has provided me with more competencies, it would be my membership in NSPI and ISPI over the years. I've now been a member 42 years.
Congratulations. On the, do you have what some might call an elevator speech, a short spiel on human performance technology or what I do? How do you, Char, how do you respond to people who ask you what it is that you do?
Well, when I think about elevator speeches, I think about it should be short and sweet. Excuse me. And unfortunately, I have not honed that skill. but I usually do talk about being involved with helping people improve their performance, and how they go about looking at the type of work they do, what influences them, and helping them to become more efficient in the process. So I can't really say that I have an elevator speech.
Maybe it's a 99 floor building.
Yeah, it has to be a tall building.
Fred, how do you explain that to people when asked?
What's the question now?
Well, what is your definition of HPT?
Well, I learned through a study that NSPI and ISPI did, I mentioned it earlier, Maury Coleman ran that study, and he identified something close to 10,000 components of it. So human performance technology is certainly underrated. Most people don't understand that it governs most of their life. The definition of it in just a few words is almost impossible. But I would say it's people reacting to information and performing appropriately. And that's as close as I can come.
Okay, good. Thank you. Char, what have you been learning lately about new aspects of human performance technology? Is there any particular focus that you have?
Well, I think watching it be applied in an organization as a whole and learning more about how to do that, I think from a perspective of helping people learn and writing materials and those kinds of things, I can do that fairly reasonably. But there are a lot of other things that I'm still fascinated by and really need to learn more about. And that is looking at business applications. Every one of them is different. I mean, there's always some routine, but there are also a lot of things that are just fun, that just make it different. And I've been really enjoying that stretch around how does it get applied in this setting versus this setting, and where does that fit, and how does it get reframed to make sense for some folks. And like I said, I particularly enjoyed our speaker yesterday, because he was really talking about very much about processes, onesie twosie sorts of things, which, yeah, we can all kind of get that. My challenge was, okay, so now that's great. How does it work when you're dealing with people who are inside their heads, which is my audience most of the time? Mm-hmm. I've got scientists and engineers, and so that visible go count the number of pallets at the end of the dock just isn't it. Mm-hmm. So how do you get them to, how do you get it to a point where you can influence their performance when it's, when they're busy performing inside their heads. Mm-hmm. So I'm enjoying learning that. And I'm also enjoying some of the original or recurrent research that is providing more of a foundation about why we do what we do. I found that to be fascinating, and feel it. The refresher's good.
Mm-hmm. Well, Fred, you've been retired for a while, but I believe that in your business that you operate in the Albuquerque area, that you're still applying human performance technology. But are there other avenues, new things that you're learning and incorporating into your knowledge base about HPT?
It moves along continuously.
Mm-hmm.
One of the disappointments surrounding HPT is that how much know-how we now possess and how much of it we apply. It's in training today, as I have observed, there's still people who believe that the technology is invested in the presentation device.
Mm-hmm.
And I have observed training now beginning with a device called an opaque projector. Do you remember opaque projector?
Yes.
And then we got the tank of training, the Bessler overhead projector, built like a tank. And we thought that and overhead transparencies was the technology.
Mm-hmm.
And then somebody put it on 35 millimeter slides.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody proclaimed that as the advancement in the technology, when the presentation mode has very little to do with it. It's how relevant the information is, how effectively you present it, how efficiently you do it, and how well you've evaluated, and it does, it really cause somebody to perform correctly, correct definition of correctly, be at the smallest possible cost with the greatest effectiveness. And I don't see very much of that around. Now, the business I'm in, however, is almost totally dedicated to the outcome. And it's, of course, seasoned a little bit with the retail requirements, retail sales requirements, but it comes pretty close to meeting the requirements of what I would call effective training or effective instruction.
Mm-hmm. Now, that business is a scuba dive shop, correct?
Well, I was leaving that out.
Oh, so well, I was going to take you there, because it does become a matter of life and death.
That's right.
There's high risk associated with this, and so not only do the retail shop, you sell the gear that goes with this, but you also do training and certification of people and take them on trips
Yes.
But that's where your application of HPT is currently for you, right?
Yes, and it's interesting. Most of the people who are involved in the process of making effective and certified scuba divers, they really wouldn't understand what HPT is.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's transparent to them, but mm-hmm. they're doing it. We're very fortunate in being in a business that, like that, that where we're allowed to do things correctly.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Let me segue here into our next question here. This is about HPT and our terminology, our jargon. Shar, is there any particular HP term that you would like to define or redefine? Perhaps it's something that's a terminology that you see or hear misused, misconstrued. Is there anything that that comes to mind?
I don't know that it's a term that is being used, and I wish they'd get it straight. it's HPI, Human Performance Improvement. Now, on the surface, that's fine, and we do use that sort of interchangeably with HPT. However, there are some organizations and some groups who use the term HPI, and it's not at all attributed to our our group, ISPI, or to the field of human HPT.
Mm-hmm.
And they are using it in such a way that it's exactly the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
So it would be really nice if they would just join us.
Mm-hmm.
You know? Because they're talking about the right things, they've got the right idea, they have their roots in other alternative groups, if you will, and they say HPI is just the greatest thing since sliced bread, and it's, you know, the person who is doing the job is the greatest influence, and you know, a lot of the stuff.
Mm-hmm.
You ask them about the genesis and the research under that, they cite folks that a lot of us have never heard of.
Mm-hmm.
And you just want to say, well, why aren't you dealing with the history? So I'd like to just bring them in.
Mm-hmm. I've heard the others in the society, HPT, is the means to the ends of HPI, and that's one another way to frame that, to bring that in. We have the technology that
will... It would be good to know that I'm learning something new.
So hopefully that catches on here, and that we can see that there's a technology as a means to the ends of that improvement, but you can have the ends in mind, human performance improvement, but if you don't have the means of human performance technology, you can't really get there.
Together, because, yeah.
Fred, how about you? Are there any terms from instructional technology or human performance technology that you feel that perhaps need to be better clarified, used more appropriately?
No, I don't. I hear all the terms, and I understand the relationships pretty much, but there's nothing in there that bothers me from the technical use of them.
Mm-hmm.
I think that often people use a term to describe something they're not doing.
Mm-hmm.
So in some environments the term HPT is sort of a buzzword that justifies what they're doing.
Mm-hmm.
But if I have any disappointment, it's about the fact that it's taken so long for it to be recognized for its effectiveness.
Mm-hmm. Well, let me shift gears here again and move to people from the past, people from the early days of NSPI, and what we're looking for here is any stories about their contributions to the technology, to the society, or any stories of a personal nature that you can share to help us humanize some of these names from the past or even from present day that are still with us here that we'd like to pay homage to. Shar, is there anybody in particular, any stories that you can share with us?
Well, I think one of the folks that Fred mentioned him earlier was a gentleman named Glenn Valentine. And I still remember one of the first times I had a chance to speak with him. He was talking about a company in which he was involved, and it was a company called Proudfoot. But I was particularly enthralled, and again, it sent me on a path of, gee, I need to figure out how I could do that. But he was explaining that their approach to working with a customer or a client that came to them was they would just take a look at the spreadsheet, the company profit and loss statement, the spreadsheet, take particular note of the areas where that company wanted to grow or on that spreadsheet what was low or having problems, and then their approach to that client was, is this something that you want to change because it's low and it needs to be better, improved, and we can do that because we have the technology and the resource and here's how, and we would bet that these sorts of things are occurring in the organization. And that was kind of their entree point. So from my perspective, to be able to look at a balance sheet or a spreadsheet and be astute enough to know where our technology influences those sort of bottom line areas, I just think that's impressive. And I still don't know how to do that, but maybe someday.
Anybody else from the past here that fond memories or exciting times?
One of the special folks, and it's just a lot of fond memories, and again, additional learning, was a gentleman named Jim Russell. I had an opportunity to meet Jim Russell when we were part of the International Board of Standards. And as it turns out, I ended up on the original IBSTIPI board because at that time, the organization where I was working said, you know, we've got this effort going on about setting standards for instructional designers, and oh, by the way, you need to go and represent us at these meetings. Mm-hmm. And so, okay, fine, you know, that's my job assignment. And I really was interested in what are the standards for our profession and what does it take to be the best and be certified and those kinds of things. And so, as it turned out, a gentleman named Barry Bratton was leading a composite group that was made up of folks from business and industry and that were associated with not only ISPI, but also a couple of the others. I think there was an ASTD person there.
Yes.
And there was somebody from, who was the technology group at the time, Society, and I don't remember if they're still around. But anyway, we were gathered because the hosting organization was hosted by Maury Coleman at Arthur Anderson in Chicago. And so our first meeting was in their boardroom, and you know, we all showed up and stayed at Arthur Anderson in the dorm rooms that, at, you know, they were, we were sort of in between, so they didn't have classes, so because it was only on weekends, so we could be there on weekends, and they had space for us. And I remember those dorm rooms were so small. And I used to tease Maury about we were just kind of in the land of the Lilliputians. but we had meetings about every 2 or 3 months. Showed up in Chicago, went down to Arthur Anderson, spent the whole weekend working on design standards for our profession. Instructional design standards, we did instructional design standards, we did instructor standards, and we did management standards. And again, that's where I got to know a whole lot of the folks by just spending weekends. Mm-hmm. On my, it ended up, I didn't get paid, I got my trip back there, but I certainly didn't get paid for the weekend. You did it because you liked it. I was there that I met Rob Fauché, Jim Russell, Ken Silber, Judy Hale, Odin Westgaard, Bob Carlton, Linda Robinson, all of the folks that are almost legendary. Mm-hmm. When we published the first set, though, so a particular story about that, we finally got them put together, the first set, and Jim Russell agreed to publish them. They were published down in Purdue. Mm-hmm. But we needed to be able to fund it. And so the person who basically put her savings on the line, and we all promised to pay her back if it didn't work, was Linda Robinson. And a lot of folks don't know Linda.
Mm-hmm. Well, and there was...
she was phenomenal.
But and
she,
there was Faith Stein and...
Oh, yeah, Faith and Kathleen.
And Kathleen. Whiteside, not Whiteside. No.
Hutchison,
Kathleen Hutchison, who subsequently worked for Sandia National Laboratories and was in one of those IPSDIPI meetings. She mentioned to Char that they were building a small elite training organization at Sandia Laboratories, and she asked Char if she'd have any interest in it, which subsequently led to Char being recruited by Sandia Laboratories
at an ISPI
meeting in Washington, D.C.
But forgot a couple of people. I also met Bill Coscarelli there, mm-hmm. Sharon Schrock, and who else? There was just a whole host of folks that came in to contribute to helping make that work. And, and over time, folks would move off the board and move on and, so it was quite interesting, the number of people who played a role in creating that work. Mm-hmm. And that were sort of the brain trust of pulling together all of the known critical pieces at that time. Mm-hmm. So it was pretty large undertaking, and it lasted about 3 or 4 years, as I recall. Mm-hmm. I was going back there on the average of, and subsequently we ended up having to incorporate. And I think Barry started out as the first president, and I became the second one. And we then had to reestablish a relationship with ISPI because a number of our seniors at the time were a little miffed about that. And I do remember meeting with Diane Dormant and Dick Lincoln, mm-hmm. And kind of explaining that our whole purpose was not to be adversarial, mm-hmm. with ISPI, but rather to support it. And that was, at that time, I think, that was when I coined the term, it's my professional home. Why would I want to mess that up? And that's kind of a term that stuck. So it's just...
Well, thank you for that, because I use that phrase myself.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So it was kind of, I remember having used it a number of times, and they seemed to resonate with that. Mm-hmm. So it was helpful.
Fred, what stories do you have of people or past events that you'd like to share?
So many of these events have occurred in parallel.
Mm-hmm.
When I arrived at AT&T as the brand new novice trainer for the Bell system, we had a guideline for all training materials, and it was called Plant Training Course Number 100, and it consisted of sheets of paper, 8.5 by 11, with one sheet had two columns on it, and the second sheet had two more columns. And the columns, as I remember, I'm not sure I could quite remember, but the first column held the general topic.
So
the second column, I can't remember what the second column was.
The time, outline.
The time column was clear over on the right, wasn't it? The time column?
Anyway, the
idea was that their conception of an instructional outline mm-hmm. was four columns on these sheets of paper. And at that time, AT&T had several hundred training courses published in that format. And so I had met Harry Shoemaker, and I realized that things were going to have to change. And so Harry and I developed an interesting relationship. It was we were good friends. First. Secondly, he was my mentor when mm-hmm. it came to instructional technology. And so we put together a joint project. And eventually it got named the Training Development Standards.
Mm-hmm.
And it was 8 volumes of guided instruction on how to go about developing training material.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the very first volume was a very slender one, and it was essentially a mini front end study, and we even arbitrarily attached a timeline to it. You could spend 80 hours investigating, analyzing, gathering information, and sometimes data on what the problem was or was represented to be.
Mm-hmm.
And in that, you also made a preliminary decision of whether or not it was a training problem.
Mm-hmm.
And we did several hundred of those job studies, mini job studies, and I have trouble remembering some of the statistics, but it seems like we ran at a 94% rejection rate.
Mm-hmm.
In 94% of the times, when an executive manager said, we need a training course to do X, was found that training wasn't the answer to the problem.
Mm-hmm.
So that cut through the cloud of relevancy. And then the second volume was what we called a front-end analysis. It was pretty much like the analysis they do today.
Mm-hmm.
Gather all the information that you can, gather data, sort out the chaff and get rid of it, and get down to the relevant things that need to be trained. And we did a third step. When the instructional design began, we have a step where we actually tested instructional design materials to see whether or not they worked and whether they caused people. And that's one element today I see left out of most of it. But there were eight phases, and the last phase had to do with going out and actually conducting a study afterwards to find out whether you spent your money correctly or not. That's another step I find mostly ignored today. This entire process was conceived in the basement of my home in Murray Hill, New Jersey. And Harry and I spent many, many weekends down there in this basement that I had refinished, put wallboard up and that sort of thing. Mm-hmm. We had charts hanging around the walls with lots of things crossed out on them and lots of things written in. And then Harry had a small staff, and he took those charts and turned them into the training development standards.
Mm-hmm.
So that was one of the great things that happened. And we, with our leverage that we had, we managed to imprint the Bell system pretty thoroughly with those standards. It became a requirement for all the companies that AT&T owned. At that time, they owned 27 telephone companies and laboratories and manufacturing companies. That was a fairly successful effort for some time to come. But back to the people who played the roles, Dr. Holt, Oliver Holt, really, he and an assistant by the name of Fred Stevenson, who was from the Pacific Telephone Company, really conceptualized, if that's the right word, the entire process. They concentrated on learning carols, halls that contained learning carols, classrooms, lights, seating, the surface that you worked on. There was one standard in there, for example, how much light should be on that surface and what the surface should represent. They did a wonderful job and got practically zero credit. Harry, by the way, he was the president of NSPI. He never was very big on taking credit for anything. And yet he played, for me, the most important role in any of this. And at the time, Gary Rumler and Tom Gilbert were publishing some of theirs work. We had already published the training development standards, and they were already in use. But being pretty much a closed company, everybody else, no one was interested in using them. But we had some wonderful experiences with them. And the stories, we could just go on for hours, the stories of the successes. And an interesting success was climbing poles. We taught people to climb poles. It was self-paced, self-administered, self-tested, and self-evaluated. And the range for learning to climb a pole ranged from 4 hours to 100. Very wide range. One of the things that drove that course cost over $1 million. But we had thousands of students go through that course, both men and women. But it was driven by the laws coming into effect at that time that we should not discriminate between male and female. Mm-hmm. And there weren't very many female who climbed poles with gaffs fastened to their ankles. That course was tested in court over 100 times, and no, it never lost a case. So there were all kinds of wonderful experiences with the training development standards. And then when they broke the Bell system up, and the companies went their separate ways, the central source of that sort of material went away. And it was no longer a requirement, and everybody came along with their ideas of what training should be, and it sort of lost traction.
But that was where we first met. You had Gary, Gary Roemmler, in to do the performance analysis workshop, because that's where I first met Gary.
Yes, Gary Roemmler played an important role as a contractor in our system, and Tom Gilbert was mostly on the roles as a consultant, but he was sort of the basic guru of the entire affair. And Harless and Roemmler both played similar roles. And as Shara said, she was a certified Harless instructor, and we had lots of those classes. But one of the things that gave me an opportunity to do, which I've been grateful for, is I was able, with a lot of support, to build a model training center for us. It even included its own hotel. It was on about 25 acres of land, and a really beautiful setting. We, at that time, we had an outdoor pole climbing laboratory. We had examples of all the equipment we used in the telephone companies for people to get hands-on exercises with. Underneath the building was a whole world of communication equipment, just like it is in most cities. We had the buried cables, and as I was leaving that, we were adopting the construction of fiberglass facilities for communication purposes. But the building also had its own model central office, an electronic
switching system.
We had our own publishing plant. We had, as I recall the figures, 56 model classrooms. And we had six Learning Carol arcades, we called them, each with about 30 Learning Carols in them. And all the support facilities. It was a self-contained operation and a most wonderful cafe.
Where was this located?
In Inglewood, Colorado. That's on the south side of Denver. Yeah.
So that took you back from New York to Denver.
Yeah, and then Char got recruited by Sandia Laboratories, and so I went along and went into another business, which also allowed me to practice what I learned in the world of human performance. So it's been a great run.
Well, it's so good for you to share with all of us these stories here, and to pay homage to some of the colleagues that you've had in the past, and the influences that you've had. And on behalf of the society, I'd like to thank you for all your tremendous contributions over the decades, and for your tremendous support and your organization's support of the society and the technology of human performance technology. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.